thank you all for coming tonight. I'm curious, how many of you have read Ayn Rand, anything by Ayn Rand? Half of you? The rest go read? So everything we do in life, everything we do in life as adults is guided by some kind of philosophy. Whether we think, whether when we look at the world or make decisions about the world, we are guided by some ideas that we've absorbed from the culture, absorbed from our parents, absorbed from religion or from the priest or from one of our classes and our professors. But we have a certain presumption of ideas in our minds that help us live our lives on a day-to-day basis. Some of those ideas could be contradictory. Some of us think it through and figure out what those ideas really are. And some of us just live our lives with this little person inside our brains telling us that's right, that's wrong, do this, don't do that, without really having thought it through and deciding what your, as an individual, philosophy is. Whether you accept science or not, and the conclusions of science or not, is going to depend on what your view of human reason is, whether you think knowledge is accessible to scientific exploration. Now, today, in the 21st century, that seems silly. Of course, we all accept scientific knowledge, right? But just a few hundred years ago, or even in America today, the people who, because it contradicts their philosophy, religion in this case, they don't accept Darwin, for example. They're suspicious of evolution because it contradicts their predetermined idea. How we view our emotions will be dictated by our view of our philosophical views of life. Should we use emotions to make decisions in life? Should we follow our passions and our emotions? Should we ignore our emotions and only follow reason? Should we do something combination, a little bit emotion, a little bit reason, sometimes this, sometimes that? That depends on your view of emotions, where do emotions come from? What do they tell us about the world? A philosophical view about what should guide our decision-making. That's philosophy. Do we believe, what kind of political world do we believe should exist? Should we make decisions for ourselves as individuals, guided by our own mind or our own emotions or whatever we feel like doing? Or should there be a state, an authority, that dictates to us what we should and shouldn't do? And what should be the balance between the two? How much freedom? How much authority? How much should be dictated? How much should be left to individual decision making? How do we know? What are the principles by which to decide which is right and which is wrong? What are the political principles? Is it just what works? But it's interesting because the socialists all believe socialism works, and they have their stories. And the capitalists all believe capitalism works, and they have their stories. How do you decide which is true? And when we study history, how do we know what really happened and what didn't happen? And what's a story somebody tells? What do they say? The victors write the history books? The people who win the wars write the stories of the battles, not the losers? How do we know what to believe? How do we know? How do we choose a path in life? You know, should you, when you graduate, a lot of students here, when you graduate from the university, should you do what you want to do? Follow your passion? Figure out what interests you, where you can make money, and go and do it? Or should you do what your mother wants you to do? Right? Mothers are important. If your mother wants you to go become a doctor, should you become a doctor to make her happy? Or should you do what the state wants you to do? Or should you do? What your friends want you to do? How do we decide what should be the guiding principles? All of that depends on your personal philosophy. There's some people who say, my life's nothing. I am a servant to the community, the state, my mother, and I just follow what they tell me to. Others pursue their own interests. That is determined by your philosophy. Again, whether you've absorbed it or whether you've accepted it explicitly, whether you've just, it's just there without having thought about it or not. But we all have ideas that guide what we do and how we do it in our lives. And one of the, I think, the most important challenges, one of the most important things to do in life, when you're young, when you're a student, you have time. You don't know how much time you have, right? But you have time. It's to take the time to figure out what you really believe about life, about the world, about your own values, about what your philosophy as an individual is. So you're not just determined, you're not just motivated by a jumble of things that you've absorbed from all these different sources, and you haven't integrated, you haven't chosen, you haven't made them explicit. So whatever you decide your philosophy is, decide what your philosophy is. Take the time. This is why liberal arts educations are good, because you get exposed to a variety of different ideas. Then you think about them, and you choose. This is for me. Now, Ayn Rand believed that there's only one right philosophy. That it's not just all these options and whatever you do, it doesn't matter. That if you care about your life, if you want to live a good life, you have to choose the right values. You have to live the right kind of life. And her philosophy, for reasons I'll explain in a minute, is very much focused on you living the best life that you can live for you. That is the principle that guides her ideas. This is why it's a philosophy for living on earth. It's a philosophy for living here, being successful here, being successful as a human being. So what is Ayn Rand's philosophy? So first, you know, the five branches of philosophy, I know how much, we won't get into this, I won't be technical, I promise. But there's metaphysics, which is what? What do we study in metaphysics? Yeah, the nature of the world, reality. What is the world like? Right? Epistemology is the study of how we know the world. We all have a view of metaphysics and epistemology, whether implicit or explicit. Ethics studies what's right, what's wrong, what we should do. Politics studies what form of government we should have. And aesthetics, which studies art and the role of art in human life. So let's take the first four, and if you have questions about art, I'll try to answer them. But let's do the first four. Metaphysics. So what is our view of reality? And you can have a variety of views. You can say reality is the creation of our own mind. There's nothing really out there. It's all our consciousness. It's our perception. We make it up as we go along. We invent reality. Your reality is not my reality. There's nothing objective out there. It's just atoms in our brain bumping around and creating something. And according to that, we all have our own reality, our own view of what things. And, you know, reality is not a thing. It's not constant. It's constantly in flux and changing and contradicting itself. And nothing's absolute. You hear that? People say nothing's absolute. Nah. your logics, your reality is your reality, my reality is mine. That's pretty typical in the modern world we live in. Or you could think, well, there's a supernatural consciousness out there. Call it God. And it creates reality. And it can change reality whenever it feels like it. So whatever laws we think exist out in reality, they can change. Based on prayer, based on wishes, based on whims, or based on whatever the God, whatever God you believe in, decides at a given moment. Now, those are different views of reality that would very much determine how you act within reality. Because if it's all in flux, if I don't know anything, what's going to happen to me? What would you feel if the world was like all the time changing, shifting, moving, you didn't know what was true and what was not? How would you feel? I'd be terrified. Fear. Powerful emotion. It's not in my control. I don't know what's really out there. Afraid, because I don't know. Rand rejects those views. Her view is reality is a constant, an absolute. It is out there. No matter what you think, what you feel, what you wish, what you pray for, things are what they are. It's an absolute. It's steady. It's constant. It is. And we all experience the same reality. We might see it from different angles. You might see the table from that angle, and I'm seeing it from this angle. So we see it differently, but we can both describe the table, measure it, show it. It is a table with specific dimensions, with specific nature, and it doesn't really change unless something happens to it. Then it'll change. A is A in Aristotle's terms. Things are what they are. Things have a nature. They behave according to that nature. It's not random. It's not somebody's whim. And it doesn't depend on my wishes. My wishes won't make it so. Wishing, praying, begging doesn't change the reality. Things are what they are. So that's metaphysics. And metaphysics, Ayn Rand, is reality is what it is. And that has implications to all of us. Science, therefore, is legitimate because science studies things as they are. And we don't have multiple sciences depending on who we are. So metaphysics is about existence. Existence exists. It is as it is. What about epistemology? How do we know what exists out there? Do we know based on our feelings? Do our feelings tell us what reality is about? Do our feelings describe the table? Or do we get revelations? I don't know if you've studied Plato, the great philosopher Plato. He has this allegory of a cave. Right? And in the allegory of the cave, the idea is we all don't really, reality might be absolute out there, but we don't see it. We're in a cave. We have no idea what reality actually is. We see shadows on the wall. And who sees reality? Who knows reality? Only certain people. With certain skills and certain abilities. Plato calls them the philosophers, and ultimately the philosopher kings. They actually commune with pure reality, real reality, the reality that according to Plato is in a different dimension, where the essence of tableness exists, where the real table is. This is just a shadow of the table. And the philosopher kings see the real reality, and then they tell us about it. So the way we know the truth is through revelation. So some kind of mystical power that we have. Think about the Pope communes with God, and that's how he knows the truth. He doesn't discover the truth using the scientific method. It's just revealed to him in some mystical phenomenon. So we can view emotions as telling us the truth. That would dictate one path of behavior. We can view an authority telling us what the truth is, revelation, and that would dictate a different path of behavior. Rand argues, in we've got plenty of empirical evidence to suggest this is true, that the truth is discoverable by use of what? How do we discover truth? If you're not sure if something's right or wrong, how do you figure out whether it's right or whether it's wrong? You look it up on Google? Well, that might be step one. You might use Google as step one. But what do you look for? How do you make decisions about what makes sense or what doesn't, what's right and what's wrong, what's the method?
Using the logic.
What's that?
Using the logic.
You lose logic, so you accumulate facts relevant to it. Now, by accumulating facts, again, you make an assumption about reality, that reality is, it really is, these facts are real. You use your senses, accumulate facts, you use Google, accumulate facts, you cross-check what you find in Google, because never trust Google, right? You cross-check everything. You accumulate facts and you use logic to find contradictions, resolve them, and discover the truth. And that process is called what?
Thinking.
Reasoning. Thinking. It's the essence of what it means to think. You figure it out. You solve a problem. There is a methodology, and we call that reason. Our ability to know the world through our senses and to use that information to come up with more abstract ideas and to discover what is right, what is true, and what is not. That is all reasoning. So, reality is what it is, and we, human beings, have the tool to discover the reality. To discover what is and isn't. To discover the truth. And that methodology is our mind, our thinking, our reasoning. Other animals, how do they know what's right, what's true or not? They're programmed to know, right? Their senses give them evidence, and then they've got pre-programming like a computer that tells them, given this data, this is what you must do. There's no evaluation. There's no thinking. Thinking is something only human beings do. Analyzing, figuring out, okay, this false fact, no, this fact, yes. Animals accept the data that their senses provide them. An automatic process goes on, bam, they act. There's no, the lion doesn't say to himself, I don't feel like eating today. I'm on a diet. They're hungry, they eat. Not hungry, they don't eat. It's pretty simple for them, not for us. And to engage our reason, what must we do? To think, what do you have to do? Is thinking just automatic? You sit in front of a math problem and it just, bam. What do you have to do to think?
Study.
Yeah, you have to exert an effort. You actually have to focus. What were you saying? I can't hear you. Okay. You actually have to exert an effort. It actually takes an act of will. And for Rand, there is such thing as free will. There is such thing as you making choices about what to think about, what not to think about, to think or not to think. You know the saying from Shakespeare? To be or not to be. In a sense, that's to think or not to think. So reality is fixed. We have the tool to know it. That tool is reason. And then what should we apply that reason towards? In morality, in terms of how you should live. Should you live for other people? Should you live for yourself? Should you live for your mother? Should you live for the group, the society, the tribe? What should you live for? What's life for? It is getting hot in here, right? Real question, what should you live for?
I think you have to live for ourselves.
You live for yourself?
Yeah.
Okay, everybody agree? Disagree?
Agree.
What's that? Agree? Well, I've got a bunch of egoists here. What's that? Not always live for yourself. Sometimes live for others, sometimes for yourself. How much?
Sometimes.
It depends. How do you decide when you do this or when you do that?
What's more demanding?
What's what?
What's more demanding?
What's more demanding?
Yes.
Yeah. Or what feels better? Or what's emotionally pleasing at the moment? But the way we know about reality is through reason. And if we decide, we have to decide how to guide that reason, what the purpose of thinking is going to be in our life. Are we going to think on how to make other people better off? Or should we think about how to make ourselves better off? And if we decide to do both, then when do we decide one and when do we decide? We have to have principles to guide us. Otherwise, it's just completely random. And then you're abandoning reason. And you're determining, making the decisions based on emotion. And emotions are not tools of cognition. Emotions are not means to know. They tell you about yourself, but they don't tell you about what's right and what's wrong in the world out there. So we need thoughtful principles about what works and what doesn't. What guides us in the direction and what doesn't. So in the world out there, there are two views of what should guide us. Mostly, right, in most of history, and most people believe that morally, from an ethical perspective, your life should be guided by what's good for? For what?
Society.
For others. For society, for the state, for the poor, for the needy, for your family, for other people. I mean, we call that in morality, we call that a morality of altruism. Altruism means other-ism. That is, your whole life should be focused on making other people better off. You should be sacrificing for other people. You should be living for other people. You should sacrifice your own interests for the sake of other people's interests. And that should be what guides you in your life. So, if you want to know what to do after university, what do you do? Well, you decide who you want to sacrifice to, and you go ask them. Or you make a list. Like, if you're going to sacrifice to society, if you're going to do what's good for society, you make a list for all the different professions, and you say, well, what does society need? Does it need doctors? Not right now. Does it need plumbers? Yeah, it needs plumbers. Okay, I'll become a plumber. Because that's what society needs, right? I mean, we all laugh, but this is what we're told. As an idea, we should pursue. Nobody practices it like this. But this is what we're told. What's good for society? Well, let's figure it out. And how do you know what's good for society? Usually, you don't. So how do we solve that problem? No, we elect officials, you know, leaders, who tell us what's good for society. And tell us what society needs. And tell us what profession we should have. And tell us how to live our lives. Plato's philosopher king in the Republic, if you've read the Republic by Plato, decides what profession you should have. Because the philosopher king knows what's good for society, and you don't. I don't trust you to decide what's good for society. So I'm going to decide for you what's good for society. Because I'm decided I'm a philosopher king. So, the alternative out there, if you say you should do what's good for society, is at the end, somebody is going to dictate what's good for society. That's how we get dictators. That's how we get authoritarians. It's this idea that you as an individual don't matter morally. That morally, what matters is the group. And somebody has to represent the group. Call in the leader, call in the dictator. And they'll tell you what to do. I mean, history is full of them. We had kings who told us what we could do. We had tribal leaders who told us what we could and couldn't do. We had religious leaders who constantly tell us what we can and cannot do for the sake of society. They're always for the sake of society. You know, what they pocket on the side, or the power that they have over us, that's not the reason they're doing it, they tell us. It's because it's good for society. if you'd ask Stalin, or Mao, or Hitler, why they were killing all the people they were killing, what would they say? It's good for society. Lenin said once, to make an omelet, you need to break a few eggs. In this case, a few eggs meant, I don't know, 10, 20 million people. You need to kill them so that the omelet, society, is better off. So it's really, really, really important to make a decision about how you want to live your life. Because that won't just dictate how you live your life, but it'll also dictate kind of the political environment that is going to be determined from the choices we make about how we want to live our lives. So one option is to live for others, to sacrifice. And a question that should be asked when people tell you that the purpose of life is to live for others, there's one question you should always ask. What's that question? Question you should ask anytime anybody tells you anything.
Why?
Why should I live for other people? I have one life, right here on this earth. One life. I'm not a Buddhist. I don't think we keep coming back. And anyway, if you were, you still wouldn't be sure because you couldn't come back as a cockroach. Right? You don't know if you're going to come back as a human being. So you've got one life. Why shouldn't I live the best life I can for me? You live for you. I'll live for me. Why is my life less important than your life? Why is my life less important than society? Why is my life less important than my mother's? Why should I do what other people tell me, not what is good for me, what I think is right for me? Every human being faces a fundamental choice to be or not to be, to live or not to live. If you decide to live, you need to figure out how. How to live, how to live a good life, how to survive, and how to thrive as a human being. In order to achieve what? What's the ultimate achievement that a human being can achieve for themselves?
Happiness.
Happiness is to be happy. What's that? So to be happy. So ethics should be a guide to how to live a good life. What? You know, ethics tells us what is good and what is evil. What should we do and what we should avoid? What we should pursue and what we should walk away from. So, if my life is the goal, if survival and happiness is the goal, ethics should tell us these are the things you should do and these are the things you should avoid. These are the values and these are the vices. So what would be if as human beings we want to thrive and survive? What's the one thing that is most important for us to do? What's that?
To do what makes us happy.
What makes us happy, but how do we know what makes us happy? How do we know what, as human beings, qua human beings, not just as an individual, but qua a human being, how do we know what leads to happiness?
By experiencing things.
Now, we don't only need to experience things in ourselves. Why? Because we can what?
We can learn.
We can learn from other people. We can learn from history. We can learn what has worked and what has not. What actually leads to human success and happiness and what doesn't. And we can also learn about what is human nature. How do we know what we know? And how are we going to discover knowledge that will lead to success as individual human beings? So what, as human beings, just at the level of survival, what do we have to do in order to survive? What's not optional if we're going to survive as a species? We have to have food, right? How do you get food? Anybody know how to get food? I know, you know, usually I ask that question, the first answer that comes back is supermarket.
Hunting.
Hunting's good, right? Somebody has to hunt it. Or old days at least. What's that? We farm, right? We farm and we hunt. Anybody here have the gene for farming and hunting? You think you have the gene for farming and hunting? Yeah. How would you hunt? What's the first thing you would need if you're going to hunt?
A gun?
A tool? Yeah. Bow and arrow? A spear? Where do those come from?
Basically, everything goes with money.
What's that?
Everything goes with money.
Everything?
Everything goes with money.
Everything goes with money. Yeah, money is a massive abstraction. Before money, everything comes from... I mean, where does money come from? Everything comes not from money. Where does everything come from?
From the other people.
What's that? Other people have to make it.
From the other people who make these things.
Yeah, so other people make these things. And how do they make them? Yeah, everything goes from here. So somebody, and this is the, I mean, how many of you are economic students? Oh, I thought there'd be more economics students. One of the great fallacies in economics, I mean, the whole field is a mess, is a disaster. The assumption in economics is there's stuff in the world, and it's scarce, and we have to figure out how to get it and how to divide it up. But there's nothing in the world. There's no stuff in the world until what? Until somebody makes it into something. A proper study of economics is not a study of the stuff in the world and how to divvy it up under scarcity. The proper study of economics is how to produce it, how to create the stuff, and then how to trade it. But not, and scarcity doesn't even come into it. So, how do we get guns? How do we get a bow and arrow? How do we get the tools to farm? How do we get the idea of farming? Because farming is pretty from the past. But how did they get it? Somebody had to figure it out. Somebody had to produce it. Somebody had to make it. Everything that we have, somebody has to produce. And somebody had to have the idea of producing it. Chairs don't just come into existence. We treat them as if. But somebody had to figure out a chair. Most tribes out there don't have chairs. They sit on rocks. For most of human history, we didn't have chairs. Somebody had the idea of a chair. None of you have a gene for hunting. You want to hunt? You have a gene for figuring out how to hunt. It's called your reason, your mind. So everything that human beings need in order to survive has to be produced, has to be figured out. Starts with our mind, starts with thinking, starts with reason. We have to learn about the world, we have to figure it out, we have to build the weapons, the tools in order to go hunting. I mean, think about the kind of species we are, right? You look around this room, right? Pretty nice group of people. But it's really pretty pathetic. All of you, pathetic. Weak. Even the strongest among you is weak from a perspective of an animal. Slow. Can't run. Don't have claws. Don't have fangs. You try running down a bison and biting it. Or fighting with the saber-toothed tiger. And yet we've hunted bison. We've destroyed the saber-toothed tiger. They're all in the museum. You guys are here. Not because any one of us has that kind of skill, strength, muscles, speed. What is it? What do we have? We have a mind to figure it out, to build weapons, to have strategies, to hunt, to set traps, to skin animals and create clothes. I mean, the parts in Europe that you can't live in unless you figure out very quickly how to make clothes. But somebody has to figure it out. So if you care about yourself, if you want to live for yourself, the number one value has to be the ability to figure it out, which is the reason, to think. So for Ayn Rand, living life on Earth means thinking. Solving problems, figuring out what is the best life that I can live using my mind. There's no other way to do it. So, you live for yourself using the tool that you have to survive, your mind, in pursuit of your own happiness. What about other people? Should we not care about them because you're just a bunch of egoists? You don't care about other people? Should you care about other people?
I think if we will be happy, we can create a society which will be happy.
So if you're happy, you'll create a society where everybody's happy. But do you care about other people if you want to be happy? Right? We said you're going to choose a career based on what? Based on what's good for you. So, should you, where, and in what context should you care about other people?
Maybe your profession is needed for other people and you can help just with it to others. If you just, for example, if you want to become a politician, why do
yeah,
you
if
want
you want to
be
become a politician, you better care about other people. Politicians are never a good example to bring up when we talk about morality.
Let's talk about entrepreneurs, for example.
About what? Entrepreneurs. Yeah, good.
Yes, about people, or we can have an example like Steven Jobs, who created the iPhones. Of course, he did it also for himself, but also he needed to help other people to communicate more comfortably.
Yes, he did it for other people, but even before we get to his customers, did Steve Jobs need other people? Yeah, of course. So how, what was his relationship with other people like? Did he exploit them? Did he use them and throw them away? What was his relationship with other people in order to achieve his happiness?
He
what did he have to do with other people?
He made their lives easy.
He's what?
He made their lives easier.
He made their customers' lives easier. What else?
He hired them.
He hired them. And even the people he made his life easier, how did he make it easier for them?
You give them money.
He didn't give them money. He didn't give them a phone. He didn't give anybody anything. What did he do with them?
He exchanged.
He traded. So, if you, the way in which caring for other people reflects itself is through trade. What is trade? I give something and what do I get in return? What's that?
Money.
Money? Maybe.
Something of a value.
Something of a value. Less value or more value than what I gave up?
More value for me.
More value for you. What about for me?
No. I get more value.
So if I give something up, what do I get in return? More value or less value?
More value.
So, I give you, so, you know, we buy the iPhone, $1,000. I pay $1,000 for this. Is that because this is worth more than $1,000, less than $1,000, or exactly $1,000 to me?
No, it costs $1,000.
Let's assume it cost me $1,000. I paid $1,000 for this. How much is it worth to me?
It depends how you're doing.
If I bought it for $1,000, simple question. I bought this for $1,000.
It cost you $1,000.
It cost me $1,000. Is it worth more than $1,000, exactly $1,000, or less than $1,000 to me?
More.
What's that? It has to be more, otherwise why would I give it up $1,000? I give up the $1,000 because this is worth more to me than $1,000. It might not be worth more than $1,000 to you, so you don't buy it. But by buying it, I've expressed the fact that this is worth more than the money I gave up for it. That's what trade is about. So am I better off or worse off by having bought this? I'm better off. When you go and buy a sandwich for $3, I don't know how much a sandwich costs, $3, right? Is a sandwich worth $3 to you or more than $3 or less than $3? More. Otherwise you wouldn't spend the $3. What's that? Well, you could buy a really bad sandwich once in a while, yeah. You won't buy it again from the same person, right? So trade is about value for value, where both parties do what? Will money exchange and are?
Win. Both win.
Both win. Trade is a win-win transaction in which I'm better off. How about Apple? Is Apple better off because I spent $1,000 on the iPhone? Yeah. They're better off. Why? How do we know this?
They keep doing it.
Yeah, because they got a profit in how much the iPhone cost them to make. A lot less than $1,000. So they got, I don't know, $400 profit, and I got whatever the value of the iPhone is to me, minus $1,000. We both won. So the way we deal with one another, if we are self-interested, if we're pursuing our life, is not by exploiting other people or by being exploited. It's by trading with other people. It's by working on win-win relationships with other people. And this is true in the physical realm of iPhones and money and all of that stuff. But it's also true in the spiritual realm. A friendship is a friendship when if both parties are enjoying it, if both parties are getting something out of it. If only one party is really happy about the friendship and the other one is not so happy about the friendship will not last. So all human relations, healthy human relations, are trading relationships. Whether it's explicit or implicit, whether it's in dollar terms or in other terms, the relationship has to be value for value, a trade. So, being self-interested, doing only what you want to do for yourself, doesn't mean going to live on a desert island. No iPhones on a desert island. No need to build weapons for me to go hunting on a desert island. Living in society is a massive value, but it's a value. It's a value if one engages with other people as a trader in a win-win relationship. Because it's not a value if I'm going to be exploited. It's not a value if I don't get better, if I'm not advancing in my own life, if I'm not able to pursue my values, to pursue what's good for me. So Rand's philosophy is about individuals pursuing their own self-interest as traders within a society, in win-win relationships. But focus on your own life, focused on your own happiness, focused on your own values. Because you live once, life is short, shorter than you guys think. And what's more important than you, to you? And of course, there's a lot you can talk about in terms of ethics, in terms of how to live a good life, what a good life actually entails, what kind of virtues one should pursue. But all those virtues need to be discovered by reason, guided by what's good for you in this life to live a happy, successful, prosperous, good life. And all of it, again, guided by reason, with an acknowledgement that reality is what it is. It's not what you wish it to be. Now, that's kind of ethics. Ethics is about you pursuing your values, making the most out of your life, using reason to discover the values and then live them. But what happens when we get into the society, when we're in a group? Can somebody stop me from pursuing my values? Can somebody obstruct my ability to trade with other people? Can somebody stop me from applying my thinking, applying my thoughts? Can actually somebody stop me from thinking?
No.
How do they do that?
By force.
By force. So force and coercion, authority, a gun. If I stick a gun to the back of your head and say, you either do what I tell you, or I shoot you. There's no point in thinking. Thinking will only get you in trouble. All you can do is do what you're told. If I tell you, you can research this, but you can't research over here, I'll never allow it. I'll shoot you if you research this as a scientist. What do? You research over there. You know, maybe at night you do a little experimentation over here when nobody's watching. That's regulations. Regulations, for example, in an economy like ours, tell companies, you can do this, you can't even think about that. Because we've decided it's good for society. In America, everybody knows that the Federal Drug Administration, which is the administration that approves drugs, right, won't approve what are called life extension products. Products that are meant just to extend your life so that you guys can live to be 150. That would be cool. Because they're not interested in that. What they want is to cure cancer and cure heart disease. If you're doing that, they'll approve it. If you're just extending life, no way. So where are people investing their money? In curing disease or in life extension? Curing disease. They're not going to spend any money on life extension because the FDA won't approve it. So who's going to even think about it? You can't think about that because they won't approve it. Now, what does it mean not to approve it? Let's say I have a little capsule and I tell you, if you take this capsule, you can add 50 years to your life. And the FDA says, no, we don't approve it. What does that mean? Literally, what are they going to do?
They're shorten your life.
Well, they're going to come and take my pulse away. They're going to stop me physically. They're going to use force, coercion, to prevent me from handing you, from trading with you for this pill. They intervene in our voluntary win-win relationship. So the one thing that can stop us from thinking, that can stop us from pursuing our self-interest, that can stop us from trading and engaging in win-win transactions is force. It's coercion. It's a gun. It's authority. So if you really want to live a good life, if you want to pursue your self-interest, if you want to pursue values and thinking and trading with other people, what kind of society do you want to live in? A society that doesn't coerce. A society where there's no force. A society that doesn't intervene in my voluntary transactions with other people. That doesn't try to tell me what's good for society, how I should live, what I should do. And that's what we call that society is a capitalist society. A society, capitalism is a system in which the government doesn't force itself on us. It protects us from coercion and force by other people. But other than that, leaves us free. Free to live our lives as we see fit. Without intervention, without intervening, without obstructing our ability to trade, to think, to produce, to make, to build. And that's the kind of society somebody pursuing their own life on this earth based on his own mind wants to live in. Not a society where they tell us how to live. Not a society that takes our money and redistributes it. Not a society that regulates what we do and what we don't do. Freedom is something that people pursuing their own self-interest demand and require for their own lives. So what is the philosophy for living on this earth? Philosophy that recognizes reality for what it is. Recognizes that we have one tool to know that reality, reason. Recognizes that your purpose in life is your own happiness, your own well-being, your own flourishing, and that there are principles on how to do that, call them ethics, and that the only society that leaves us alone in order to live such a life is a free society, a capitalist society, a limited government society. That's philosophy for living on this earth. Thank you. I'll take questions. Any questions? Yeah, that was quick.
What if in a win-win transaction, it affects others? Like, it's not only two person trading, like, maybe others are affected by...
Give me an example.
iPhone. So, iPhone sending this iPhone, but it's exploit the mineral.
not a lot. It's not illimited. We have to take it, the minerals from Africa that will affect the environment there, and it will exploit the people who will go for very few salary in India or in something. So there is a win-win relation maybe for the customer, for the producer.
So there's an iPhone. And to produce the iPhone, there's an entire supply chain of things that go to mines in Africa, factories in China, factories in South Korea and India and all these places. And all these people are affected by this one product with a whole supply chain. So think about the supply chain as discrete transactions. Right? Forget about the iPhone. Right? There's a factory in China. And the factory in China is assembling all this stuff. Right? And the factory in China, in order to assemble the stuff, what does it need? People. Let's start with people. So what does it do? How does it get people to come and assemble stuff in the factory in China? Now, what's that?
They hire people.
Why do people come and work in factories in China? Okay, so if, and this is a big if, right? If the political system is such that they are forced to go and work in factories in Africa, in other words, they're slaves, then it's immoral. That would be wrong. And I would not buy an iPhone if that were true. So to the extent that people are being forced, guns are being used, coercion is being used on people, in order to force them to do something, then that's wrong. That's immoral, and that's unjust, and it shouldn't happen. Now, that's not what happens in China. Nobody is forced in China to go build iPhones. They are not forced in China to build iPhones. And you can go and interview the people who build the iPhones. You can go live with them. You can experience what it's like, as people have done. And it's not. What is the situation? The situation is they're very poor. They live in horrible conditions in the countryside. They live in the same conditions all of humanity used to live in, which means you farm, you grow the food, and you eat it. That's how all of us used to live 300 years ago. All of us.
Yaron, can I comment?
Yeah.
Just about China. Recently it was announced that German companies are going away from China. You know why? Because the salaries became so high in China that it's not worth anymore to continue working in China. And you are saying that they are forced to work. It's not forced, but they are free in that side. What is wrong in China, this is enough, you know? It's not that they are forced to work there.
No, they're not. So what happens is that farmers in the countryside, very poor. And then Apple comes in, or a German company comes in and says, we're going to offer you more than you can make in the countryside. A lot more, it turns out. Because then they move from the countryside to the city, millions and millions and millions and tens of millions of people, hundreds of millions of people. They work in the cities. Not only are they making enough to eat, but they're making enough to live and send money back home to the farm where their grandparents and their kids are still living. Until they make enough money, and then they bring the kids with them into the cities. And the fact is, 30 years ago, the entire population of China, 1.3 billion people, were dirt poor. I mean, dirt poor is like $2, $3 a day or less. And today, what percentage of the Chinese population is $2, $3 a day or less?
Three.
Tiny percentage. Yeah, 3%. 3%. It used to be 100 or 95. If you weren't a communist party official, you lived a good life, but everybody else was doing poor. 95% of the Chinese population count out from absolute poverty, and a big chunk of them, hundreds of millions of people, are middle class. How did they become middle class? Not because of slavery, not because of force, but because there was a little bit of freedom. And they had opportunities. A Western capital came in, built factories, and they got jobs. And they became more productive. Now, why are wages going up? Wages are going up because they're more productive. And now, what's going on, I think the reason people are leaving China now is because trade barriers that, you know, Trump and regulations that the Chinese government is imposing, and they're driving up the cost of labor artificially. So I consider that a trade win-win. Apple wins because it gets relatively cheap labor. Although, you know why Apple goes to China? Does it go to China for cheap labor? Why does Apple assemble its iPhones in China?
Not only because it's cheap, but there's so many people who know how to assemble it.
Because in China, they can get 200,000 engineers tomorrow if they need them. They can't do that in Silicon Valley. There's just not enough people. If the United States had more open immigration and you could bring them to America, then maybe they would do it in America, but you just can't get the numbers. And it's not just engineers, it's tool makers. And people who make stuff that is necessary for Apple. China has those capacities. The rest of the world just doesn't. They've developed. Now, at some point along that chain, in Apple's case, there probably is real exploitation going on. And the reason for that is local political dynamics in the country. So, for example, certain minerals are mined in Africa. And they're not mined. It's not kosher, right? It's not right the way that they're being mined. But why is it? It's because the countries in which those mines are have no freedom, have no capitalism, have no rights. They don't protect anybody. Everybody in those countries is a slave to the government. Who does one blame for that? Who do you blame for that? I blame the country, the leaders, the people who set up the political system in those countries. The problem in the Congo is not Africa. The problem in the Congo is the Congo. They have a corrupt political system that doesn't respect the rights of individuals. But along, you know, Apple products are sourced from 60 different countries. Every one of those transactions has to be a win-win transaction. Otherwise, people wouldn't engage in it. Except, again, there's some mining issues in Africa, which I acknowledge are wrong. But again, not from Apple's perspective, but from the local perspective of the local government. One other thing I want to say just about your comment, because there was a lot there. There's limited resources and we're using them all up. There's no such thing as a limited resource. Earth is limited? You know how much? You know how much of the earth? You know how much of the earth we've used so far? How much metal, how much of the available metal in the earth have we used so far? Nothing. It's not limited. So when we run out of earth, what will we do? What will we do? Nothing. No, what would we do? I mean, have a little bit of... No, let's think this through, right? Let's say there's 500 tons of whatever in the earth, and we run out of it. What do we do then?
Invent something else.
All die? Find alternatives. We're very good at it. I mean, all of human history is a good example of how we find alternatives when something gets too expensive. What else can we do? Are we really limited to this little ball here called Earth? I mean, the Japanese just landed a spaceship on an asteroid with the idea that we're going to go mine on the asteroids. Now, you think it's funny, but people used to think that getting oil from the depths of the ocean, going drilling into the depths of the ocean, was science fiction. And now we get a bunch of oil from the depths of the ocean. Why can't we get minerals from asteroids? We will one day. What's the moon for? There is no such thing as limited resources. Because the only limited resource is our imagination, is our ability to think and discover and find new stuff. How many times, just in my lifetime, I've heard that we've reached peak oil. There's no more oil. And then some genius figures out another way to find more oil in a different way, like right now, fracking. Now, granted, there's a finite amount of oil in planet Earth. So what? We live in the best environment for human beings have ever lived in, ever. You drink the cleanest water you have ever drunk, ever.
It's poisoned by the water here. Lead, full of lead.
Your water, I mean, if you've got lead, then fix it. But the fact is that human beings, today are living longer, healthier, better lives than ever in human history. Do you know why Europeans drink beer? Because water was undrinkable in the rivers and lakes beforehand. So they had to drink beer because they needed to avoid. Why did the Chinese boil? Not boil. Why did they drink tea? Because it forces them to boil the water. Because the water used to be undrinkable. You think nature is clean? Yeah, nature is filthy.
To pollute water, right? We didn't understand the science behind it at the time.
Like, now we have the science, so we clean the water.
But that's the reason, perhaps, why they drank the beer.
No, they drank it because they didn't know how to clean the water.
Yeah, but they didn't have the knowledge.
No, all they knew is if you drank the water, you died. You got sick. So they had to develop alternatives. It's not that they had an understanding of the knowledge of why, but they drank the water and they got sick. So they figured out alternatives to it. Today, our water, even with the lead, is cleaner than it's ever been for human consumption.
In Roman times, the lead was normally in the wine, for example. Everybody in the water, they use the wine.
The air you breathe is cleaner today than it's ever been before. You think that living in a little mud hut with wood and cooking in the wood inside the little mud hut, the air you were breathing was cleaner than it is today? No. There's a reason why your life expectancy is well into the 80s, maybe even higher than that. Why we live healthy lives, much healthier than our ancestors lived. It's because our environment, human environment, is the best, cleanest for human beings than it's ever been before. But I know, we're so spoiled today. We live with such expectations that now we can measure to the millionth of whatever, every particle in the air, and we all get hysterical because, oh my God, we've got particles in the air. We've always had particles in the air. Now, we can actually filter them out. You can have an air filter at home and get pristine air relatively cheaply. Human environment, again, the human environment. If you're a snail or a spotted owl, I have no guarantees. But for human beings, it's never been better. And it's one of the most depressing things is how depressed you guys are about the environment. The environment's great. Now, human beings can clean it more, can make it better, sure. We are all the time. And by the way, the richer we get, the cleaner the environment is. The more capitalist the country is, the cleaner the environment is. The more we care about individuals, the cleaner the environment is. The filthiest countries in the world were communist countries. The filthiest areas in the world are public property, because it doesn't belong to anybody, so nobody cleans it. My backyard is quite clean. I take care of my stuff. People take care of their stuff. So, we're not destroying the environment because we're mining. We're using the environment to better our lives. And the environment, in and of itself, is not a value. The only thing of value is our lives. What gives other things value? God. What gives them value? Only you can give stuff value. There's no intrinsic value out there. The earth is not valuable in and of itself. The earth is there for us to use, to exploit. The mind. And that's how we survive as human beings. Human beings don't just adapt to their environment. Human beings change their environment to suit their needs. We chop down trees to build houses. We blow up mountains to build, you know, buildings from rocks. We build dams in order to produce electricity. The only way human beings can survive is by changing the environment. If we stop changing the environment, we die. We do. There's no way for 8 billion people to live on this planet without agriculture. But agriculture requires massive changes to the environment. Chopping down forests, and growing corn, growing wheat. What's that?
Permaculture is up to 15 years.
cannot grow enough food for 8 billion people with Puma, whatever. You just can't. It's science fiction. It's like the idea that we can create enough electricity for the whole world using solar energy. It's just as ludicrous and just as science fiction. Yes, we can all go back to the caves. We can live in caves. But then life will suck. Life is great right now. It's fantastic. Stop being so depressed and worried. No, it's there are fewer poor people in the world right now. There are more people who are middle class. There are more wealthy people than ever in all of human history. There are more opportunities for young people globally than at any point in human history. Life for a human being has never been better than it is right now. We can make it better, sure. But let's figure out where we are first before we start getting depressed and starts changing the world. The world's not ending. It's not going away. The world is not dying. It's thriving. There are more forests today than there were 100 years ago or 150 years ago. Partially because of technology, we can grow more food on smaller plots of land. So we've abandoned land to forests now. Other questions? Yeah.
Well, first of all, thanks for your great speech. I have two questions. First is that, what do you think? Why did Ayn Rand dislike libertarians and libertarianism?
Why did Ayn Rand dislike libertarians and libertarianism?
And second is, on what aspects does objectivism contradict libertarianism?
All right, so I mean, I think the answer to both of them is the same. I don't know exactly what libertarianism is, right? Because it's a lot of different things, right? You've got a variety of different anarchists over here. From anarcho-capitalist to anarcho-communist to all kinds of anarchists who call themselves libertarians, right? I mean, it's true. All the way to classical liberal, limited government, small welfare state. You've got now, if you can find it online, bleeding heart libertarians.
That's a blog.
What's that?
That's a blog.
That's a what?
A blog.
Yeah, it's a website called Bleeding Heart Libertarians. A bunch of philosophers who are libertarians. Who want a minimal welfare state, and they even want universal basic income. Right? So you've got libertarianism is anywhere from universal basic income, redistribution of wealth, to, I don't know, all kinds of variations of anarchy. So, why is Ayn Rand against that? Because she's against UBI, and she's against anarchy, and she's, you know, where is she in between? So, first, the term libertarianism doesn't mean that much, because it's so wide. It's so disclosed. Ayn Rand had a very clear view of what the world should be. And she defined it, and she called it that, and she thought it was meaningless and confusing to have this wide variety of people, right, who claimed they were for liberty when she doesn't consider UBI pro-liberty, and she doesn't consider anarchy pro-liberty. So what unifies them? So that's one. Second, Rand really believed that in order to get to liberty, and in order to understand why liberty was good, you had to have a philosophy. You had to have views on all the things I discussed today, metaphysics, epistemology, and primarily morality. That politics didn't come out of nowhere. So libertarians claim to have a non-aggression principle, although the people of UBI say it's okay to use aggression sometimes in order to provide the funds for UBI. And that anarchists, in my view, you know, they monetized aggression. So it's not clear that there's a non-aggression principle because now it's a tradable commodity. We can have a debate on anarcho-capitalism if you want. She says you can't have all of this if you believe in the non-aggression principle. And the non-aggression principle is not obvious. You have to understand where it comes from. And is it a principle? And what's that principle based on? And it can only be based on a particular morality. And the morality can only be based on a particular epistemology. So she thought libertarians, in a sense, what they cake and eat it too. They don't want to define themselves. They don't want to make what the clear agenda is. and it's too wishy-washy, and no philosophical foundations, so therefore the whole thing collapses. That would suit you. And the contradictions are there. If you're an anarcho-capitalist, I think that's in contradiction to objectivism, because objectivism does not believe you can trade in force, does not believe that is a commodity that is tradable. And if you're a UBI libertarian, a bleeding heart libertarian, then you violated the non-aggression principle by raising taxes to get the UBI. So, you know, she was very friendly with certain people who would call themselves libertarian, like von Mises, Hazlitt, and others. And she despised other libertarians, like Rothbard, and many of the others, because of she considered anarchy anti-liberty. So that's where the contradictions.
Because the force can be traded. Or
what's that?
Because in anarcho-capitalist society, as you said, force cannot be traded. Why cannot it be traded?
We can get into the whole anarcho-capitalism thing. Watch my debate. There's a debate on YouTube where I debate an anarcho-capitalist in Poland for about a year ago. Anarcho-capitalism is basically a negation of the idea that force is special. Force is different. In my view, in objectivism's view, force is anti-life. Force is anti-reason. Force is anti-capitalism. Force is anti-markets. It's a different type of human activity than any other activity. You want to treat it just like iPhones, just like legitimate things that human beings do, and create a market in it. I think that's untenable, impossible, self-destructive, and contradictory. And all it leads to is, and every anarchy leads to ultimately force. That is, it leads to violence, it leads to civil war. I mean, we have anarchy today in certain parts of our economy, like the mafia. The mafia functions on the basis of anarchy, right? Have you ever seen the Godfather movie? Right? You have your police and legal system. I have my police and legal system. I'm one family, and you another family. And how do we resolve disputes? Well, once in a while, we'll have a council meeting. We'll get the council together, and the council say, well, you need to pay him compensation for... But then I'm unhappy with that deal, so I slaughter half of your family. So you come and slaughter half of my family. And that's private law. That's private armies. That's private police forces. It's the mafia.
It's a state of war.
What's that? It's a state of war. It's a constant, permanent state of war. That's what anarchy is. That's what anarcho-capitalism is. And all the examples I've read from David Friedman and all the rest, all the examples of permanent states of war. I'd rather live in a socialism than anarcho-capitalism, because I'm less likely to die. So, anarcho-capitalism is anti-liberty. It's anti-freedom, because it elevates force above reason. It makes force part of what we transact, and it makes force something that we clash over constantly.
So, and why are you so sure that limited government won't grow?
That what?
Limited government won't grow.
Did I say I'm sure? No, I'm not sure. When it comes to human beings, I'm not sure of much, right? There's no guarantee limited government won't grow. It's our job to make it not grow. It's our job to enforce that it doesn't grow. I mean, even in 1776, or when they, 1789, when they did the American Constitution, somebody asked Franklin as he was leaving the Constitutional Convention, said, what have you given us? And he says, a republic, comma, if you can keep it. It requires vigilance. Liberty requires vigilance. Eternal vigilance, they say, right? Now, the more we know, the more vigilant we can be. I think the founding fathers of America did the best that they could do, given the circumstances that they have. And they established a system that created the greatest country in all of human history and sustained economic growth, sustained prosperity, and relative freedom for 250 years. Not bad. But it's decaying. It's decaying because they didn't build a philosophical foundation for it. They didn't have the tools to preserve it, and we, not you guys, because you don't live in America, but we in America betrayed it. We turned our backs on it. But that would happen in any system. No system can sustain people who don't believe in the system anymore. So today, we know a lot more than the Founding Fathers did. I think we could create a much better constitution, a much better government, a much better system than they did. Will it always exist? I don't know. It depends on people. It depends on the choices they make. It depends on their philosophy and their ideas.
Yeah. My question is about parents and their kids. Do parents have any kind of responsibility for their kids? And what kind of trading relationship do you come with them?
So what are the responsibilities of parents towards their children? So I think parents have a lot of responsibilities towards their children and a lot of obligations towards their children. This is why I tell people, don't have kids unless you really want them. And unless you know and acknowledge and accept the responsibilities that you're taking on, because it's a huge thing to have kids. It's not a trivial issue. It's not easy. It's massive amounts of work, massive amounts of effort, massive amounts of money. So your responsibility as a parent is to raise the kids to be the best human beings they can be. Teach them how to think, teach them how to live, give them the basic skills up until the age of 18. Up until they can take care of themselves, whether it's 17, 18, 19, it doesn't really matter. But up until they are adults and can take care of themselves. That's the responsibility you take on when you have kids, is to take care of them up until that age. What's the reason to have kids?
No, to have this responsibility.
Well, because you're bringing a life into the world. It's a life that didn't choose to come into the world. You made the choice. Children cannot take care of themselves. You, by having kids, are taking on the responsibility for taking care of them. You have acted in a way as to bring something into existence that didn't ask to be into existence. This is why I think that kids don't have a responsibility towards their parents. It goes one way, because they didn't ask to be here. It's an action the parent took in order to bring the kid into the world. Now, if you love your parents, then you have a responsibility that that love creates, right? But you don't have an obligation inherent in being a child of somebody to take care of your parents. You only have an obligation that's chosen because you love them, because you care. Some parents don't deserve to be loved. Some parents are nasty. Is dependent on what? Other people's? So my happiness is dependent on somebody else's unhappiness. I can't think of a situation like that where I'm going to be happy if you're unhappy. Why?
If you build your success, the other people... If you build your success, your life, your success to the other people's unhappiness. I mean, I don't agree with your idea, because I believe in God and I believe in the unconditional love. And you mentioned the trait in the relationship.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's interesting how you come up with the philosophy.
Because I don't see. So to me, love is a response to something, it's a response to values. If you don't have any values, I'm not going to love you. I love my wife, but it's not unconditional. I can think of a number of things she could do and I would stop loving her. And we all do. You can pretend there's such a thing as unconditional love, but it doesn't exist in the world. I mean, maybe some parents love their children or pretend to love their children unconditionally. But you know what? If certain things that my kids will do, and sometimes they come very close, I will stop loving them. Love is not, I just have the emotion and that's it. It's a fixed, it never changes. It changes for all of us. If you get married, I don't know if you're married already, but if you're married, there's certain things your husband will do and make you stop loving him. You don't love your husband unconditionally. So, I don't believe in anything's unconditional. Everything is dependent on the value the thing has to you. I don't think there's anything other than you for you. So, I believe that my happiness is dependent on other people's happiness, not on unhappiness. I mean, if my wife's unhappy, I'm unhappy. One of the things that makes me happy is when she's happy. Again, it's a win-win relationship. It's not a lose-lose relationship. So I want the people around me to be happy, to be successful, to do well. And that makes my life better. I can't think of a situation where somebody else, unless they're my enemy and I hate them, right? Where somebody else's unhappiness makes me happy. It doesn't. Yeah.
Why do you trust Buddhist from what you call Buddhist health? I think definitely because the police from the government is near one hand, right? And
there's no competition. I get it. I get it.
And in a free trade, there's a lot of choices you can make. So
okay.
Why do you trust only one choice from government?
Because I believe there's such a thing as objective law. I think there's certain things that are wrong. No matter whether you think they're right or not, they're wrong. And I want a police that identifies the things that are wrong and excludes them. I'll give you an example which I gave in this debate that I did, and I encourage you to watch it because we cover a whole gamut. I think having sex with children is wrong. It's evil. It should be outlawed. But let's say, I don't want to point at you, but let's say there's somebody over there who thinks sex with children is fine. And they found a police agency that agrees with them. And their police agency is going to be fine with sex with children. And let me finish. No, this is not a pretend situation, because this is, Walter Block talks about this and he defends this, right? He defends this idea. And there's some parents who are willing to give their kids to have sex with. And there's a police agency and a legal agency that's willing to protect that.
So where is the...
Now that is evil.
No, where is the personal freedom in this case? Because
whose personal freedom? Their personal freedom to have sex with
children. Personal freedom. Child's personal freedom. Because if someone... Wait.
But that's the point. Anarchy has nothing to do with personal freedom. Anarchy has nothing to do with personal freedom. Because if the market dictates, if the market competition dictates that a particular police force doesn't believe in personal freedom, then there's no personal freedom. My whole point about anarchy is that personal freedom goes away under anarchy. It doesn't survive for 5 minutes. You think there was personal freedom in Iceland, in David Friedman's favorite example of Middle Ages Iceland, where they were all slaughtering each other left and right?
So fascists do not believe in personal freedom.
That's right. They don't believe in personal freedom.
So how are you going to stop this?
I fight them.
So we fight them?
Yes. So it's violent. But you see, I'm saying it's sad and unfortunate that we get into a situation where we're fighting, where there's war. You're legitimizing it. You're saying it's okay to have various police forces with different definitions of personal liberty, with different ways in which they believe personal liberty is implemented, and I'm supposed to live with other police forces in the same geographic area that each has a different definition of what personal liberty is and how to defend it, what property rights are, and what contract law is. Each one is different. And we're going to fight all the time. That's all we're going to do. What I want is I want a geographic area where the personal liberty, personal freedom is defined in a particular way here. You want something different? Go over there and create your country over here. So I believe in competition. I just believe the competition has to be in a different geographic area. You cannot have overlapping jurisdictions in the same geography. It doesn't work. It leads only to violence. It cannot work. So you want to try your fascist experiment over there? Fine, I'm not intervening. As long as you don't attack me, I'll give you a law. So how do we deal with fascists? We ignore them. If they're over there, if they're in here, we outlaw them. Fascism is not allowed. You don't get your own police force. But you see, in your system, the fascists have their police force, the commies have their police force, I have my police force, five other versions of libertarians have their police forces. How do we resolve disputes? By shooting each other. Until who wins a shooting match? You know hostile takeovers in like business? The hostile takeovers? What's a hostile takeover look like between two police forces in a private? It's hostile. The guy with the bigger gun takes over the guy with the little gun. Now, I don't mind monopolies in business. Right? And I don't mind monopoly over the use of force, government. But a monopoly dictated by the marketplace for the use of force is really scary. Because it means that the most ruthless, brutal, biggest gun is going to win it out and dictate everything. Right? So if all the phone companies merge and you have one phone company, that's fine, I don't care. Because I know there'll be alternatives and I know there's substitute products and I know that markets don't work in that way. But that doesn't work with force. Force is different. Because you can get shot. Apple can't shoot me if I use Samsung. But your police force can shoot me if I don't want to use you. They can come to me and say, you either sign up with me or we shoot you. Who's going to stop them? My police force? My police force doesn't have as many guns as your police force.
Your police force is the government.
Yes, I want the government. The government is a necessary good, not a necessary evil. You see, there are many types of... Let me give you another example. I don't know why this is so hard. There are lots of institutions out there. For example, scientific knowledge, is it determined by the marketplace? By trade? No. Experts decide. They figure it out, and they decide what the truth is. You don't have to accept it, but that's what science is. Newton did not trade. He discovered it, and then he told people about it. He taught it. That's an institution of knowledge that is not market-driven. Law should not be market-driven. It should be like science. The principles of law should be discovered by scientists. In this case, scientists of law, philosophers of law. And law is a different institution than a marketplace, just like physics is a different institution than the marketplace. The idea that everything has to be in a market is wrong. Force needs to be monopolized. It needs to be extracted from society. It's the one thing that must not be traded in. Rothbard is nuts. And the anarcho-capitalist, it just doesn't work. And it doesn't make any sense. And at the end of the day, it results in disaster. And I know it's appealing, but you know, because every talk I give, people ask. You can ask the same question.
The same thing, but.
Yeah, you can ask it.
Yeah. My question was that you mentioned the gangs, right? Like mafia. First question is yes, what's the difference between mafia and the state? The gangs like mafia and gangs like state. And the second thing, and I don't believe that the mafia will not have the same influence they had if government didn't exist. I think
No, if we didn't have a government, everything would be mafia. Mm-hmm. They would have much more influence. Yeah. Look at stateless societies today. Somalia. What do you have in Somalia? You have gangs. Competing gangs. All over Somalia. And the gangs. And it's a disaster.
There is a state in Somalia.
There's no state. There's no government. There's no central government. There have been long periods of time where there's been no government in Somalia. That's why libertarians love to use Somalia as an example. I don't know for what, because it's a disaster.
Okay, for example, what if government would disappear in Norway? They would just kill them. In Norway, for example.
In Norway?
Yeah, they would kill themselves.
It would take about a year or two, and you'd start having mafias and start shooting each other. Yes.
What?
You think?
What?
Why? Because there's no other way to resolve disputes. Why? There's no authority.
There is a court. There is a million courts.
No, there are a million courts. What happens when the courts disagree?
Yeah,
Yes. What happens when the courts disagree? There's no authority, there's no final arbitrator of what the law actually says, because there is no law, because there are five laws, all in the same geographic area. Let's say your law defines my property this way, and somebody else defines my property that way. How do we resolve this dispute? Well, if I got a bigger police force, I know how to resolve the dispute. So, in year one, where Norway goes anarchistic, in year one, they start shooting at each other. By year three, you have authoritarianism. That has to be the outcome. The outcome of anarchy is authoritarianism. It's a dictator. And there's a big difference between the mafia and government, a huge difference. I mean, thank God, right? The government in Norway is not driving around shooting people in the streets. The government in Norway, for the most part, secures and protects individual rights and doesn't violate their rights and doesn't use violence as the tool on a day-to-day basis, right? So the government in Norway is nowhere near ideal. It's still pretty bad, but it's much, much better than the mafia.
But the Texas are day-to-day basis violence.
Yeah. So, yes. But they don't shoot you if you don't pay your taxes. Yes, you go to jail, a little bit better than shooting. Well, it's just, I'm not justifying governments as they are today. I'm just saying they're much better than a mafia. If you want, you know, you can go to certain neighborhoods in New York, you can go live by mafia rules. Not a good, probably not in New York, but there are places in the world where you live by mafia rules. Believe me, they're a million times worse than living under a government, even a bad government. This is why you wouldn't want to live in Somalia, even though there's no real government in Somalia. And private law, you know, David Friedman uses this example of private law. He uses Sharia law under tribal law in Somalia. Okay, you might be okay with Sharia law, but I don't think your girlfriend would. It's pretty brutal to women. But it's private. So it's okay. There's no government. So it's not okay. People have rights whether they're recognized or not.
Yes, and, but the same things happen, like North Korea exists and nobody's...
Yeah, but I don't use North Korea ever as an example of something good. David Friedman, your advocate for anarchy, uses Somali Sharia law as an example of private law. I would never use North Korea as a good example. North Korea is evil, right? Sharia law is evil. I don't want Sharia law under anarchy, and I don't want North Korea. I want a particular form of government. Only one particular form of government is good. Everything else is bad. I don't need competition. I know exactly what's good. I don't need competition to define what's good. You need, in any system, you need a final authority over the use of force. If you don't have that final authority over the use of force, then all we do is land up fighting over the final authority for the use of force, which leads to authoritarianism and dictatorship. So if you want to move the world towards North Korea, anarchy is a great step in that direction.
Yeah. Yeah, I was going to agree with you because like every time we use force, every time the use of force occurs, it means that reason broke down, right? It means that negotiations broke down and there is no reasonable outcome already. So. We're not talking about morality already. It's outside of the moral.
But there's no morality in anarchy because there's no standard in anarchy. Anarchy is whatever you want it to be, and whatever police force, as I said, with child, sex. If there's a group of people that want to have sex with children, and they can find a police force, somebody with a gun to protect them, that's okay. They could be your neighbors. So morality is broken down. There is no moral. There is no guide. My point is, there is absolute good and bad. There are objective laws. There are correct definition of property rights. And there needs to be somebody who defines those things and then implements them. And there needs to be checks and balances and ways that we can dispute when we think things are wrong. And, you know, this is basically the American system of government, which can be improved significantly, but it's basically the original conception of government, which I think works and is right. Okay, we'll take one more question. Huh. Two more questions.
Yes, okay, my question was, if there are any cases where the two institutions that was mentioned by him coexist with each other or cooperate, like the government and the state?
Sure, there are lots of situations. Gangs often cooperate with the state. Not my state. Not a good state. No, the two are clashing. The state wants to crush the gangs. But anarchy legitimizes the gangs. That's what I don't like about it.
Okay, you mentioned that police compete to use violence, and I think that's where it's wrong, because what police do in anarchy, they compete to defend you, to find the best way to defend you.
That's right. So if I'm the guy having sex with children, my police force is going to do whatever it can to defend me. I don't want to live in a world like that.
I'm sorry. Rothbard has his natural limits. I mean, the natural law becomes impossible. The same sex with children, pedophilia, like this. It means that he has another mechanism of keeping the.
And who executes, who decides what natural law is, and who then is the final authority with regard to natural law? There is no entity, because that's exactly what government is. But once you reject government, you reject the idea, and I think Rothbard believes in that. But Walter Block points out, there is no arbitrator, therefore anything goes. Anything goes. So, yes, morally, these things are wrong. But who actually enforces them? Nobody can enforce it if I have a protection agency that's willing to protect me. If I like stealing stuff, you know, pickpocketing here and there, and there's a police agency that's willing to protect me, then I'm protected. Come and get me.
It's real politics,
yes. It's the way the world works today, right? If countries steal from one another, and there's no, the world in a sense of foreign policy is anarchy, right? And countries, you know, Russia wants to take some of your land, they take some of your land, who's going to stop them? It's immoral, it's against natural law, it's not right, but who's going to stop them? Now, in international affairs, we accept that. But now you want to bring it out to every little decision every individual wants to make? That would be nuts.
Gonna stop them now?
No. Now?
Russia, for example.
Nobody. But we accept that. I mean, that's part of life in an international order. But now you want to take that, which is a bad thing, and you want to bring it down to every little decision every individual makes. Nobody can stop a pickpocket. Because there's no final authority, and if the pickpocket doesn't abide by Rothbard's natural law, he believes that picking pockets fine, and there's a police force to defend him, that picking pockets fine.
Thank you.
The anarchists are here. That's okay, because it's the most dominant, for young people, it's the most dominant view within the libertarian movement. It has a certain appeal to its logic. It's like seems consistent. It's built on a morally corrupt foundation, and it rejects the fundamental philosophical issue here. It rejects the objectivity of law. It rejects the idea that there's certain things, as Rothbard hints, that are absolutely wrong, and that somebody has to be the final arbitrator of those things, and somebody has to define those things. And that's what the institution of government, you don't want to call it government, call it something else, but something, there has to be an entity that protects those laws that go beyond. All right, thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. By the way, tomorrow, 10:30, we have another lecture in Black Sea University. You're welcome. If you have time and chance, just come there. And the topic will be different. Variety of capitalism, so maybe you have more argument tomorrow. And of course, we are continuing our autumn series Friday evening. Please come again, and we'll have the next lecture for that series as well. So, bye bye for now.
Check out my debates on anarchism and my YouTube channel.